Everyone is looking for love. And they're desperate to find it.
We must show them love.
We must introduce them to love, to Jesus. To Jesus. For this is true revival. Love is all they need. Everlasting love. Rise up and go and show them love, revival love, supernatural love. Jesus is love.
We are living in a day and an hour where the harvest is ripe. People in the nations are crying out, wanting to know Jesus. They're lost. They're confused. What they're living through in life has no answers, and they're looking for those answers. It is the time for us to reach out like never before. And in the Middle East, there is so much hunger for Jesus Christ. And our guests today are going to be sharing about that hunger. And it's so awesome to have you with us today. With me today, I have Petya and Arman Lalana. And you are from the Bridge of Intercession, not Intercession, Bridge of Intercession Ministry. So we're so glad to have you today because you have published Ali the Immortal, which is a testimony of a man who was in darkness. He was a drug dealer, he was a kidnapper, he was a murderer, all those things, and came into prison and found Jesus in prison. And then you eventually connected with him, and we're going to hear all about that and how God is using you to reach people in the Middle East. Now, you are Bulgarian.
Yes.
And you are working in the refugee camps in Bulgaria where lots of people are coming, and we're going to talk about that more in our second part of the program. But we want to talk right now about the Middle East and the hunger to know Jesus. Can you share a little bit about that with us?
Well, right now, there are about 228 million people living in Middle East. And statistically showing that in the 1900s, there were about 20% of those people were Christian. And now this number has dropped down to about 2 to 3%. That just shows the vast need of really touching those people with the love of Christ. A huge percentage of those people have never heard the good news about Jesus Christ.
Right.
So we really have to reach to those. This is a tremendous opportunity.
Why do you feel that there, like, it went from such a huge percentage to such a low percentage? Did the church stop preaching and reaching out? Or what do you think the reason of that is?
Well, the main reason, I believe, is the persecution that the Christians are facing, and many Christians are fleeing those areas. So, for example, since 2014, where the big crisis with the refugees started, I'm sure many people are aware of that, millions of refugees left Middle East, and primarily most of the people left Syria, but also there are people from Iran, Iraq, Afghanistan,
right.
Pakistan, Kurdistan, all those areas, and they try to escape and move to Europe for the sake of their lives.
And a lot of times they do come in through Bulgaria, trying to get into Europe further to find freedom.
Yes.
And you were telling me in the green room that many of them are Christians already that are in the refugee camps, but many people are searching there.
Actually, the percentage of the Christians is very low that comes, because just in 2015, 1.5 million tried to escape to Europe. So Christians as percentage of this 1.5 million is low. So there is a lot of Muslims also that are coming.
Right.
And they got highly disillusioned by the horror that they experienced, even Muslims in their countries. And because in their countries, the religion dictates their lifestyle.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't have a choice. And
they
this is all that they know.
Yeah.
They don't have freedom. So many of them started searching for a better life in Europe, using the crisis just to come. But when they reach to the borders of Bulgaria shares a border with Turkey. So Bulgaria is the land connection between Middle East and Europe. And when they reach to the border in Bulgaria, they're directed to refugee camps. And the first time we went to a refugee camp, we met with Christians only, but we realized that actually the rest, they need to be reached with the love of Christ,
right,
as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. And they're coming to know Jesus too. We've done a bit of work in the refugee camp, and it was amazing, the hunger to know Jesus, because when, I mean, every soul has this innate knowing that
yes.
we belong to
yeah.
God and that we're to be reconciled
yeah.
to God.
Yeah.
And until Jesus comes into our life, there is no hope, there is
yes.
no answer.
Yes.
And
absolutely.
We know that innately.
Yes.
We know that. So every individual is really on a search, even if they're
yeah.
not aware of it. But you guys are reaching them right where they're at. I love the story that you share in your book about Ali, his story, because He was like really supernaturally, and in fact, he moves in a lot of the supernatural. You were sharing some of the miracles that you've heard him do, and he's a good friend, so you knew these, you know these are accurate.
Yeah.
But when he was put in prison for a crime,
yeah.
He was put in solitary
yes.
confinement. But somehow he got a Bible. Can you tell that story of how he came to know Jesus?
Yes. So what happened is, Ali, maybe I should just say a few things about Ali, how he got there.
Mm-hmm.
So what happened is, Ali was involved as an ambulance driver. He served during the Holy War between Iran and Iraq. But he saw all the cruelty in the war, and he got very disheartened. He started questioning his belief system, because he was a devoted Muslim, but he started questioning that, how can people do these kind of things to each other in the name of the same God. So later when he got discharged, and actually this is where he got his nickname, Ali the Immortal, because he was going to places saving people's lives with his ambulance where nobody else would dare to go. And he never got wounded in that war,
mm-hmm.
which was a miracle on its own,
right.
Considering all the things and the horrors that he went through during those years there. But after that, he got involved in the underground world. In Iran, he started doing his shady business. He became outlaw. In a self-defense, he hurt somebody and he killed somebody, so he had to run for his life. And then he went through Turkey. He ended up in Europe. He kept doing what he's doing. And he was well-connected in the underground world. So this is how eventually he ended up in prison in Bulgaria. So he served 14 years out of 20 in prison in Bulgaria, and four of those years were in solitary confinement. Just horrible
solitary
situation.
Solitary confinement. For
now,
how many years?
4 years.
Come on. Can you imagine that? I mean, that takes supernatural grace even to be
yeah.
in
yeah.
that state for 4 years.
Yeah, and to remain sane, because people
mm-hmm.
say they get crazy, like they
yeah.
just lose their minds after a month or something. But somehow God's mercy was with him.
Mm-hmm.
So what happened is, because he was transferred through those years, he was transferred through different prisons. In one place, he met an Iranian guy who was carrying a Bible with him. And they moved the guy, but the Bible remained. So the Bible was in Farsi. Ali can read Farsi. That's his native language, of course. So he opened it, and he was always mocking the Christians, because Ali is a hardcore person. He's a macho man. But at the same time, and he was mocking Christians because he thought they're like goody-two-shoes. They're always so
right.
kind, always meek. And he opened, but see, the thing that kept him really prisoner to his belief system was the fact that because of all the bad things he has committed, according to his belief system, he knew that there is
no hope.
There is no hope. He's doomed. So that's why he just kept doing what he's doing, because he knew he's doomed anyways. Now he opened the Bible and he realized, hey, there is a remission of sins. There is a Savior that already paid the
Come
price
on.
So you can live.
Come on.
So that was the thing that really hit him in his heart.
Wow.
And this is actually in the prison cell, he received his freedom in the spirit.
Isn't that amazing?
It is amazing. So he had to get into prison to get free.
From his past.
Yeah, from his past. And later on, he met with a friend of ours, Pastor Ivodor Kovachev, who is prison ministry in Bulgaria. And he became like a mentor to him. And
wow.
this is how he got shaped into the leader that now
he became this amazing leader, moving in the supernatural. This is a true story, and I highly recommend go to their website. Find out more about their ministry and how they're reaching out to the refugees and how the Middle East is coming to them. They're finding, you know, thousands of people in these refugee camps that are needing Jesus. So I highly recommend getting this book. You'll be amazed at the miracles, all that God did, the revelation that's in this book. So go to their website. It's on your screen right now, and get in touch with them. And I also want to say this, is that religion, any kind of religion,
it goes in
even in Christianity, if it's a form of religion only,
yes,
it's going to bind us.
Absolutely.
Because you never feel okay. You always feel shamed. You always feel degraded. You always feel hopeless. Religion will do that. And I just sense that there's some of you watching this right now that you have that hunger to be set free. I remember before I gave my life to Jesus Christ, I felt trapped. I felt like I was so wicked on the inside, so dark on the inside. I didn't know that I could be set free having a new life. It takes a supernatural move of God's love and forgiveness and mercy to do that. And it's available to every single person. It's available to you right now when you call on the name of Jesus Christ. He found Ali in the prison cell, solitary confinement. He's by himself, but God found a way to get that word so that he could understand the forgiveness of sin and that he was acceptable to a loving God, and it transformed his life. It can transform yours too. This gospel, this good news of the kingdom is for every person. And so the gospel spread through Ali because it's so infectious that once you come to know Jesus, you can't help it. But I just find it so interesting that the gospel began in the Middle East.
Yes.
And now it's coming around, and God's placed you right there to reach out to these hungry people.
Yeah, we believe that the revival is coming to the Middle East through the underground church.
Yes.
And when we reach to these people, they reach to their people. And this is how revival is going to come through the people, because they come with new, fresh faith now.
Exactly. And they've got relationships
that
they can share with. You know, when the jailer got born again in the book of Acts, everyone was affected, right?
Yeah.
His family and everyone in the prison got affected too. And the gospel is, it's so amazing. We're finished on this first segment right now, but you're going to want to stay with us. We'll show you how you can get this book. But we also want you to come back, because we're going to talk about what God is doing in the refugee camps and even how you can be involved. You can reach out. You don't have to be separated from what God is doing in this hour. We'll be right back.
Life affords us many opportunities to leave an eternal mark in history. In the end, all that matters is what we've done for others.
What I love about Patricia is that she is just a solid, laid-down lover.
I see Jesus in everything that she does.
What you see is what you get. It's just a real person.
It's encouraging to see what God is doing in her life.
We can do more together than alone.
I love this ministry.
I love their outreach to sex trafficking and kids at risk.
When you partner with this ministry, you get to make global impact into people's lives.
I feel like the Lord has aligned me up to just sit under her mantle and giftings.
We partner with Patricia because she is a sold-out lover of Jesus.
Just because I'm connected, I receive it.
It's just like sowing and reaping. Like, you sow, you're going to get abundance.
So when you break through for him, he breaks through for you.
God blesses us when we step forward in our faith. I just encourage everybody to become a partner. It just takes you up to another level.
Partner with Patricia King to spread the love of God around the world.
Your soul is the epicenter of what happens in your life. Patricia King's book, God's Law of Attraction, takes you on a riveting journey from God's perspective through your soul to discover the secret to a life of abundance and success.
Well, welcome back. This is a very exciting topic that we're discussing today about the harvest and what God is doing in the Middle East and how this great harvest is coming in this hour and how we can be a part of it. And we're so glad for the work that you're doing and, of course, all the network of churches that you're working with locally in Bulgaria and around the world, people who are helping, because this is a big assignment. Not one person can do it. It's the whole body together.
Absolutely.
But before we broke, you were going to be sharing a testimony about how this gospel is spreading and giving some examples of how, like, when one person gets born again, what happens.
Yeah, so see, the outcome of those refugees after the refugee camp is there are three ways it can go. One way is for those people to continue because majority really want to get into Western Europe for a better life and try to establish there. And it's amazing, people that have received Christ in the camps, they go in Western Europe and often Ali receives calls from the pastors there and saying, hey, so-and-so arrived here and he's saying he received Christ with you during his stay in Bulgaria in the camps. Is that true? Which is amazing testimony. You can get to see the fruits. Another portion of people, they decide to go back for one reason or another, either being deported or out of their own will, they decide to go back to their countries of origin. And we are receiving amazing testimonies there. For example, last time when we were visiting there and we were sitting with Ali and discussing stuff, he received a call from one of the guys that went back to Iran. And he was talking that he's in a store and talking to a lady there, but he doesn't have the answers of the questions that the lady is asking. And he said, Ali, could you answer those questions for me, please? So Ali took the phone and Ali is talking in Farsi in Bulgaria and talking to the lady in Iran, answering questions about God and
so
about
amazing.
The good news.
So amazing. It spreads like a holy virus,
it
right?
It does.
It's just
it
so does. Awesome. It's beautiful. I want to share a little bit out of the word about our obligation to help those who are in bondage. And you have some tremendous stories about, you know, the people that come into the refugee camps, what they've suffered.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And I want you all to put yourself in the place. I mean, can you imagine having to flee from your country? This is everything that you're comfortable with, your career, your family, you know, everything that was maybe happy for you in life, you have to leave because of the crisis going on. But you don't know where you're going to end up. You're taking risks. Your life, your health, your provision, everything is at risk. You literally have nothing, and you have to go through a lot of perils, a lot of different things to get through to a place of hopefully safety.
Yeah.
And then when you arrive, some of these people, they've been in refugee camps for years now.
Yes, that's
never
true.
Gotten
that's
out
right.
of the refugee camps. Yes. What would that be like if you and I were in a refugee camp with all the life that goes with that? It's not an easy life. And so we have an obligation to reach out. As Christians, we need to reach out. And I praise God for your ministry that is reaching out. And again, if you want to get more involved and find out more about this, go on the website. But in Job 29, it speaks of Job having so much anointing that his steps were bathed in butter and he had a voice in the city square. And it says why? It's because he delivered the poor who cried for help.
Yeah.
And you can feel the cry of the refugees. You can feel it, you know. And it says, and the orphan who had no helper, and some of the children in the refugee camps, their parents have died. Yeah. They have no one. Yes. You know, and it would be terrifying. The blessing of the one ready to perish came upon me. I made the widow's heart sing for joy. I put on righteousness and it clothed me. My justice was like a robe and a turban. I was eyes to the blind, feet to the lame. I was a father to the needy. I investigated the case which I did not know, and I broke the jaws of the wicked and snatched the prey from his mouth.
Yes.
And the reward of Job's life's anointing and blessing was because he positioned himself like you folks, positioning yourself to reach out to those in need.
Yeah, that was the call of the Lord in our lives. And it was interesting because one day through prayer, God took me into his heart. And I was completely drenched in his liquid love, but then he took me to the nations. And it was very interesting to see, to experience his heart for the nations. And then he started giving me these prophetic dreams about refugees. So this is how we decided that we need to reach out. And this is how we found out that Lee Dini, he started going to camps and visiting and preaching the gospel. But when we came in partnership with him, this is actually where the work started growing. And we are reaching to thousands of people, thousands of people. We're providing hot meals, providing baby formula, diapers, through another organization, clothes, shoes, strollers, everything that is needed is brought into the camps. And we support Lee in full-time ministry position. We support the transportation teams, vehicle recently purchased through our ministry, because we need to show the love of Christ to all of them, not just to the Christians, to all of them, because they live in these deplorable conditions that are just, we cannot even imagine living there for 2 days and they stay there for months. And when we reach with the love of Christ, these people start asking questions. They're like, why are you doing this for us? And they're suspicious in the beginning. But when they see the same faces going there, the same people reaching to them with the unconditional love of Christ, asking nothing in return, preaching the gospel, delivering them, many of them come depressed. Many of them are suicidal, because they went through so much in their ways. They witnessed so much horror. And when they come to the camps, they're so depressed and heartbroken. I mean, just terrible stories. Sometimes their kids get raped on the way and it's like killed. And I mean, it just, I cannot even, horrible stories. And when they come and when we bring new life and hope to them, they get revived and they start moving forward with their lives. But they're also very hungry and thirsty for what we offer, not just the material side, but the physical, the spiritual as well. And we give them free Bibles. And they have a lot of time to read, and they start asking questions, and they start coming for the meetings. And after that, after they receive Christ, they go through water baptism. There is Alpha course offered in the camps in their native languages.
Beautiful.
And for some of the people actually that return to their countries, we're offering discipleship as well. So we're continuing to build the underground church.
Because you're building the individuals, and as they get built, they'll share with others.
Yes.
You also mentioned to me about the need for deliverance and inner healing, because I can't even imagine the trauma to the soul. I mean, we go through things in our Western culture here that we think are big issues and we get healed for them, right? But they're nothing usually compared to what these people have been through. It makes our worst situation look very pale in the light of what they're going through. So you were sharing with me that you're engaged in a lot of inner healing and deliverance as well.
Yes. When we practically, when first time we visited a camp, we got to minister only to Christians. And this is when we realized we have to reach to the rest as well, not just Christians. But it was amazing just to hear the stories of those people, what they have gone through. I mean, I cannot even imagine somebody going through such things. And yet, when we start worshiping together, there was so much power in their worship. They didn't abandon God. No matter what they went through, they were still loving God with all their hearts. And that was the only place of refuge and hope to them. But we ministered to them, and there was so much healing and so much joy after that. It was amazing to see those faces. Their countenance changes because they have gone through so much. And they don't question if God exists or not, but they almost question how in the world that can happen to me if I'm God's child, right? And it brings different level of freedom when you are able to minister to those people, so they can really experience the freedom, no matter the past. And they can move ahead with the destiny that God has for
them. It's so beautiful. Jesus offers us all freedom. That's what his salvation, it offers wholeness and deliverance and prosperity and everything that makes a life rich. Yeah. You know, it's all found in Jesus, no matter what you've been through. I want to share out of Isaiah 58 as we wrap this time up. It says, is this not the fast which I choose? And in other words, he's saying, it's not about being without food and water. It's about a sacrifice, a sacrifice of looking to those who need help. and being able to reach out to them. It says, is it not to loosen the bonds of wickedness and undo the bands of the yoke and to let the oppressed go free and break every yoke? Is it not to divide your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? And when you see the naked, to cover him and not to hide yourself from his own flesh or own family. Then your light will break out like the dawn and your recovery will speedily spring forth and your righteousness will go before you. The glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call and the Lord will answer. You will cry and he will say, here I am. Right now, as you are sitting comfortably in your living room or study or wherever you're watching this, right now, there are people suffering all over the world. And we can all do a part. We can all do something to reach out. Your life is important. Your life can transform another who can then transform another and who can transform another. And I know that many of you who are watching, you have a burden for those trapped, imprisoned in false beliefs and in oppression who are living in the Middle East, in Eastern Europe, in refugee camps. I know that your heart is specifically burdened for these things. And I'm asking you to engage, even if you can just do a little, just a little part. If a whole pile of us do a little bit each, then we can make a difference. So I just want to encourage you, go to their website. It's on the screen right now. And see how you can participate. You can make a difference. One day we're all going to stand before the Lord. And we're going to see the reward of his suffering come forth unto him. You can be a part of bringing him that reward. God bless you. And thank you both for joining us today. It's been awesome to have you on the program. Thank you.
Thank you, Patricia.
Thank you, Patricia.
Life affords us many opportunities to leave an eternal mark in history. In the end, all that matters is what we've done for others.
What I love about Patricia is that she is just a solid laid down lover.
I see Jesus in everything that she does.
What you see is what you get. It's just a real person.
It's encouraging to see what God is doing in her life.
We can do more together than alone.
I love this ministry.
I love their outreach to sex trafficking and kids at risk.
When you partner with this ministry, you get to make global impact into people's lives.
I feel like the Lord has aligned me up to just sit under her mantle and giftings.
We partner with Patricia because she is a sold out lover of Jesus.
Just because I'm connected, I receive it.
It's just like sowing and reaping. Like you sow, you're going to get abundance.
So when you break through for him, he breaks through for you.
God blesses us when we step forward in our faith. I just encourage everybody to become a partner. It just takes you up to another level.
Partner with Patricia King to spread the love of God around the world.
Thank you so much for joining us on today's program. My prayer is that you will know the love of Jesus Christ in a deeper way than you've ever known that love before. And that you will not only be filled for yourself, but you'll let it pour out to those around you. You'll let that love pour out to the suffering, because that's what our life in Christ is all about. For God so loved the world that he gave himself. He gave all that he was and all that he has. And so let's be like him and give ourselves, to spend ourselves on the poor, the suffering, and the afflicted. God bless you. And remember this above all else, that God loves you with an everlasting love. He really, really does. We'll see you next time.